The subject tonight, as you know, is called Why Freedom? The subject of liberty has been at the root of the American story from its very inception. Yet what liberty is and the role it rightly plays in society has been hotly debated throughout history. There have been different theories of liberty. There have been many theories against liberty. Do individual rights to choose and act freely conflict with claims for entitlements to health, welfare, safety, and the environment? What is the basis of freedom? Is it a legitimate basis? And how do you persuade others that a free society is a valuable thing to pursue, a valuable thing to defend? With the collapse of the Soviet Union, state socialism has been widely discredited, as we all know. But as Nobel laureate economist James Buchanan has stated, Leviathan lives on and continues to grow. I think one of the key questions is not just why does collectivism endure, but what does collectivism have to do with the topic tonight? Is collectivism itself immoral? Is collectivism fundamentally dysfunctional socially and economically? Is individualism a natural right? A couple programs back, we had a talk by Randy Barnett where he was talking about the differences between natural rights and natural law. That relates in part to our topic tonight. As you all know, government plays a pervasive role in virtually all aspects of our lives. The decisions of politicians and bureaucrats not only reach into our bedrooms, our jobs, our bank accounts, anything that we consume, things we choose not to do, things we choose to do, but moreover, it extends around the world. It affects the people, the lives of people in Kosovo, in Kenya, in New Delhi. This evening, we're privileged to have two distinguished political philosophers discussing our topic. As I mentioned, the format will be a sort of informal debate. Each of with the two speakers will be asked to speak for about 20 to 25 minutes. Afterward, they'll each have about 5 minutes to reply to one another, and then we'll open it up to Q&A from everyone here. So to begin the program, our first speaker is Tibor Machan. Tibor has been working for 30 years, would you say, Tibor? In the field of political theory and political philosophy, especially pertaining to liberty. Tibor is distinguished professor of philosophy at Chapman University. He's a research fellow at the Independent Institute. He's also a research fellow at the Hoover Institution. He's a consultant to Freedom Communications. I mentioned he's editor of Reason Papers. He received his PhD in philosophy from the University of California, Santa Barbara. He's taught at many universities, most recently at Auburn University. He's also the author or editor of many books, some of you may be familiar with, including Capitalism and Individualism, Commerce and Morality, Human Rights and Human Liberties, The Libertarian Reader, Rights and Regulation, which I was also privileged to be involved with him on years ago. Tibor has also been one of the most prolific writers that I know who's interested in these topics. His articles have appeared in hundreds of outlets, scholarly journals, as well as popular publications. He also has time for a syndicated column somehow. But in any event, we're privileged to have Tibor tonight, so he'll be our first speaker. So, Tibor, would you like to start out?
Thank you very much. I appreciate your coming to hear us. Although the ad says that we're going to talk about rights to health care and all those fancy neologisms, we're not. You can see that in our books. Both Jan and I have battled those battles all over the place. We have argued against positive rights and defended the essentially negative nature of rights or liberty. What we are talking about today is what sort of an argument is the most effective, which one is the best argument in defense of the free society, roughly speaking. I put it in terms of the Constitution of Individual Rights, and I'll let Jan put it the way he wants to put it. Let me first say that I begin here with a critique. I criticize what is called social contract theories, and I will characterize them briefly, although in some ways we should have started the other way around, because this is Jan's position, and it would be nice to have him laid out for you before I get at it. But since he's been on record for a while, and since this is a fairly well-traveled area of political philosophy, I will take a stab at characterizing it. Social contract theories essentially argue that in the course of developing human community life, the way in which the norms of such community life become established and become effective is by way of a either actual or imaginary social contract. That is, the people involved either tacitly or explicitly come together and agree on certain rules that seems to appeal to them because all of them have certain goals and purposes to pursue, and the rules that most broadly satisfy their pursuit of these goals and purposes will most likely be adopted and adhered to. And in some versions of this theory, a government is established so as to apply sanctions against those who refuse to live by the tenets of the contract. In other versions of the theory, maybe no government is established at all, but some private enforcement agencies make sure that the tenets of the contract are adhered to. I'm putting this rather generally because I want to do as much justice to the diverse ways in which it's put. I argue that social contract, and actually I prefer the word compact because the term contract is a legal term, and it is suggests that there is already a legal system in force, whereas in fact in the original social agreement there can only be an agreement or a compact, not a contract, since there is no legal authority established yet that would stand behind and uphold the contract. So social compacts, I would argue, cannot establish binding norms. They do not have that dynamic power. They cannot instill any sense of obligatoriness for those who participate in them without something else lying behind the social contract. That is, all by themselves, social contracts are not adequate, I will argue, to establish these binding, ongoing social norms which are required for a free society, for a functioning free community. And my reason for arguing this is basically this follows. When social contract theory grew up, when it became more prominent in Western political theory, there were other things that were also being offered up, including a theory of human rationality or motivation. Now, in the ancient times, when one asked what kind of society we ought to have, the emphasis was on the ought. There was supposed to be some sort of an argument based on human nature or divine law or something like that that imposed either commandments or responsibilities. And out of these commandments or responsibilities, human beings supposedly had a sense that they ought to do the right thing, and if they didn't, they would be either punished or meet with severe repercussions in their lives. And the binding nature of these commandments or responsibilities had to do with there being not in accord, but with their being in accord with human nature and thus facilitating human flourishing in community life. And so there was a sort of a moral normative background to having these laws established, probably originating with personal ethics and then issuing in certain social, political, legal norms. But this was dropped, especially by Thomas Hobbes, because the very idea of human nature came under serious attack. The idea that there is a stable human nature which human beings can learn about and identify, and in terms of which certain principles of conduct, including social norms, might be identified, went out of fashion. There were all sorts of reasons for it, many of them epistemological, some of them metaphysical. Suffice it to say that a very different approach was taken to understanding human life. One of the most important features of this approach, especially exemplified in Hobbes's view, is that human beings were now thought to be driven, like the rest of nature, by certain impulses, certain drives or motivations. The very idea of motivation relates to the concept of motion. And Hobbes had this notion that everything in nature is basically driven by a certain law, and that includes human beings, atoms, pebbles, animals, everything. In the case of human beings, this law essentially came to be understood as the preservation of one's life. That is, it was understood that we are all basically driven to preserve our lives. It may take many, many different forms, but the bottom line is that it was a given, except in some very aberrant cases, that human beings would pursue a course of conduct that would secure for them the preservation of their lives. Maybe even a flourishing of their lives, but at least the preservation of their lives. And this was understood as a kind of a built-in motivation. This was not something that one chose to do. This was not something that one could ignore or evade. This was something that was given in one's nature as a material entity, amongst other material entities that were very similarly driven. Now, in the Hobbesian analysis, when you came upon a circumstance of human beings acting on these impulses, on these drives, and finding themselves in conflict with one another, then through their use of their intelligence, they would come upon the idea of forming some sort of a covenant, because the clashes became self-destructive. And notice that the fundamental drive is to preserve your life. And when that drive is not satisfied through the ordinary behavior of human beings in what used to be called the state of nature, then it would behoove human beings to form a contract and establish rules that once again would enable them to preserve their lives. And this would be understood as a kind of a necessary outcome of the development of human community life. Now, the reason that social contract theory then makes sense in this framework is that there is this given drive to reach an agreement. But what if there is no such drive? What if, in fact, human beings are not driven to reach this agreement and to enter into a covenant with one another? What if they could pretty much neglect it or overlook it or ignore it or go to sleep on it or whatever? And that is one of the problems with this view, is if the assumption of being driven to form the covenant is dropped, and I think it has to be dropped because there's just plenty of example of human beings who don't care one whit about a covenant, who don't care one whit about making things work out well, who don't even care about preserving their lives. What if that is something that doesn't work out? Then what is left of the social contract? The social contract doesn't have any force. It doesn't have anything that motivates them, and it doesn't have anything that keeps it in force over the whole, of the long haul. The notion that you are obligated by the social contract makes sense if you have this push to preserve your life. Then when you form the contract and you realize that only with the contract in force can your life work out pretty well, then you have this drive to adhere to the contract. But if this drive is missing, then you have nothing that motivates you to keep to the contract. And any time you don't like it, or you don't think about it, or you don't, you find it too inconvenient, you drop the social contract and you violate the social rules that are required by it. So that's one of the problems that I see with the social contract. Very often, however, the way the social contract view is rescued is by importing another element, not so much the drive element that I'd already discussed, but another element, namely that human beings are going to be reasonable. They're going to be reasonable, and therefore they will select these rules. It's, after all, if we are interested in preserving our lives, if we want to flourish, if we want to have to peace, want to have peace in a community, it is only reasonable to enter such a social contract. Why wouldn't we do that? It would be insane not to do it. However, at this point, I would argue that this brings in something in addition to the social contract once again. The earliest one was the drive. Now the drive is dropped. Now something else, reasonableness, is brought in. But reasonableness is not, again, something that is guaranteed. Human beings very often do very unreasonable, stupid things, self-destructive, insane things. And when they enter into a social contract, they very well could next day do the unreasonable thing and not abide by it. And indeed do a lot of things that undermine the social contract. And I think there is plenty of evidence that that's in fact what most of them do. That there are all sorts of agreements that make good sense for them to enter into, but as soon as they enter it and they get tired of it, or you see an opportunity to dodge it, they'll dodge it. They'll become unreasonable. Now, of course, if you take it as a norm of human life, the kind of Aristotelian norm that we ought to live by right reason, by prudence, that people ought to be reasonable. And then there is this tacit imperative to be reasonable. Then the social contract, added this norm, can have its desired function to preserve the peace. Because sanctions can be issued either by law or by social pressure for people to be reasonable. And if it in fact turns out that there is justification for such reasonableness, if being reasonable is indeed the right way to be for human beings, then in addition to the social contract, there is this imperative to be reasonable that sustains it. However, without the imperative to be reasonable, without the norm, be reasonable, the social contract once again lacks sustaining force, according to what I see here. Now, I have an alternative, and that's to go back to the Aristotelian notion that there really is a human nature. There is nothing problematic about human nature if you do not want out of it something that Plato wanted, namely a permanent, perfect form that is totally timeless and lasts through eternity. If human nature is more reasonably understood to be a sensible categorization of various things in the world, including human beings, then we can tell, well, what is it that makes human beings human? Not just something that we created, but what is it about them that makes them human? And one of the things that we can come up with, I think, and obviously I can't make this out completely, is that human beings have this unique capacity to think things through. Unlike other animals, they actually have to figure things out. This is a unique human aspect. Other than, there are other things that make people human, but one of the distinctive things that makes people human is that they have to think. They have to figure things out. Now, based on this fact that human beings, no matter where they are and what circumstance, they must use their heads in order to get by in life, there can be the imperative that for the sake of their succeeding at living, they must make the choice to think. They must make the choice to address issues, to attend, to be attentive, to heed things. And for that, you need a free society. If you are not free, you cannot make the choice to think. You are perhaps commandeered to think, but that's very different. You are regimented to think, but that's very different. And so that goes against your human nature. What coincides, what is fitting to your human nature, is the condition of being able to run your life with your making the choices about it, starting with the choice to address things, to think things through. Now, there is no utopia in here, because clearly some people won't make that choice. But the imperative to have social rules that make the choice possible seems to be adequately implicit in this understanding of human nature. It's a very quick thing, and I'll come to my final point now. What then is left of social contract if you take my approach to justifying freedom that I just outlined for you? Well, there is something very important, and we see it in Locke and some other social contract theorists, and that is that the norms that are derivable from human nature and from human purpose to live, to succeed in life, these norms require some sanctions. And without people agreeing to adhere to these norms, to uphold the law, so to speak, the sanctions will be missing. So social contract sort of adds the force behind the norms. Social contract by itself, I would maintain, is not adequate. But once you do have norms that you can identify, you also need a social contract. You need to have sufficient number of people to back up the rules of social life, so that those who are recalcitrants, who are violators of the law, meet some sort of rebuke and do not go free. So I do not dismiss social contract entirely, but I want to combine it with a normative theory of human behavior, including social behavior, with the social contract backing up the ultimate social norms. Thank you very much.
Our second speaker, as you know, is Jan Narveson. Jan is professor of philosophy at the University of Waterloo in Canada. He received his PhD in philosophy from Harvard University. His books include, in addition to The Libertarian Idea, Morality and Utility, Political Correctness For and Against the State, which is his most recent edited book, and Moral Issues. Professor Narveson has been a contributor to many scholarly volumes, and he's been served also on the editorial boards of numerous journals such as Dialogue, Ethics, Philosophical Research Archives, Journal of Social Research, Social Philosophy, and Social Philosophy and Policy. He's a member of the Royal Society of Canada, a distinguished society of scholars in Canada. He's also taught at Stanford University, Johns Hopkins, Bowling Green, where he's been a fellow, and the University of Calgary. It gives me great pleasure to welcome Jan Narveson.
All right. Now, the subject that Tibor and I are disagreeing about probably isn't what you think. We don't disagree that there's a fundamental moral and political principle, libertarianism. It says, roughly speaking, everybody has the right to do whatever they want to, so long only as in doing so they don't interfere with the like right of everybody else. Or to put it another way, we both agree that the fundamental rule in social life is don't use force against innocent people, only against people who have in turn used it against somebody else. All right, so that's the substance, the substantial view about morals and politics on which we agree. Our question is, why should we buy this view? Why should we think that this is the right view? Now, in order to locate what may or may not be our disagreement, and I must confess I'm not entirely sure that we do really disagree, despite what Tibor seems to think, but we'll see. But in order to get at this, we've got to locate the subject more precisely. Now, it's very, very important that what we're talking about is a certain subset of norms. It's not norms in general. It's not values in general.
It is rather what I'll call moral and political principles. Moral and political principles differ from lots and lots of other values. For example, consider the value of art.
Now, I happen to be terribly interested in classical music. I attach a great deal of value to, for example, the string quartets of Joseph Haydn. I imagine a lot of you probably don't. I hope I'm wrong about that, but statistically, there's a good chance that I'm not. Right? But you and I mean, I'm sure that everybody in this room is well aware that we can disagree about things like that without disagreeing or coming to any sort of blows about moral and political matters. As Plato pointed out, those are the ones where you expect disagreement to be serious and to come to things like wars and fist fights and that sort of thing. But there are lots of other values besides those. Now, people sometimes do come to fisticuffs about their taste in music, etc. And when they do, they then drift over into the area that we are talking about. Now, the contractarian view about the foundations of morals and politics, as I call it, is a very distinctive view, which has been developed over really a couple of thousand years. There are hints of it in Plato's Republic, but certainly the first real development of it was by Thomas Hobbes in the 17th century. I think that Hobbes was essentially right. And the question is, why do I think so, and what's he right about? Now, what I think he's right about is this. Well, what are moral and political principles anyway? They have the following important properties. Number one, they're addressed to everybody, not just fellow music lovers, for example, all right? But everybody, whatever your tastes, whatever your interests in life, the idea of moral principles, such as don't kill people and so forth, is that absolutely everybody is bound by this. So they're addressed to everybody. And number two, they claim to be authoritative. Right? Now, what do we mean by authority? Well, authority means roughly this. If your personal interests are at variance with what these principles require, then you lose, to be brief about it, right? But Mom, I like killing people. I don't care, right? I mean, killing people is wrong, and it doesn't matter what your interests are. It doesn't matter whether you happen to like torturing people. You can't do it. That's the idea of morals. I mean, the idea of morals, and I mean, by the way, we're talking here normative politics. We're not talking about constitutions written by somebody. We're talking about the bases underlying constitutions that might be written by anybody. And for that reason, I mean, that's why I say moral political, because moral principles are the principles underlying the right kind of politics. That's the idea, anyway. So our question is, what could be the foundation of principles like that? Now, there are, you know, quite a lot of essays on this subject by lots of people. But we can really reduce the field quite a bit, because I'm inclined to divide the field into three sort of views. View number one is what we might call unlimited self-interest. It's the view represented by Thrasymachus in Plato's Republic. Those of you, I imagine a lot of you have probably read that. And if you haven't, let me recommend it. Wonderful book. There's this bloke named Thrasymachus who comes storming in into the middle of this discussion that Plato and, you know, some other more civilized people are having. And the subject is, what is justice?
And Thrasymachus comes in and he says, look, you guys, I mean, I'll tell you what justice is. Justice is the interest of the stronger party. That's what it is. Now, that may be true about American justice today. It might be true about the legal systems of a lot of places at a lot of times, but it isn't what you and I or anybody mean by justice, right? When we claim that something is just, we don't mean it caters to the interest of the strong. What do we mean? Well, the answer is, we mean that it's in accordance with a principle which is addressed to everybody and has some real claim to authority over everybody, not just the strong. And the question is, where can a principle get this kind of substantial underpinning, right? Now, if we appeal to unvarnished self-interest, as Thrasymachus does, we rapidly get into trouble. It's perfectly obvious that just because I want something or other, that doesn't make it right. Whether it's right is a further question over and above the question whether I happen to want it. So the question is, what further do we need, and how do we go about getting the further thing that we need in order to make the thing work? Now, all right, what's our project? Answer, try to find some principles which will appeal to everybody. Now, about the word appeal, of course we're talking about reason. We're saying, well, what's a good reason for embracing a certain principle? And who has, how can we go about having good reason for all of us to accept a certain principle? Tibor complains about this kind of theory that it isn't going to tell us what to do about irrational people. And I agree with this. But I don't think it's going to help much to read Aristotle either. Right? I mean, if people are irrational or suicidal, for example, then it's perfectly true that no set of political principles, mine or anybody else's, is going to persuade them to do the thing you want them to do. If they don't want to do it and they won't listen to reason, what are you going to do? And the answer is, well, if they attack you, you kill them. Because it's all you can do. I mean, might, you know, the force is all you can resort to against somebody who isn't reasonable. But obviously, the only people we can appeal to here when we're trying to find some philosophical argument is rational, reasonable people. So, and that's all that Tibor can do, too. Nobody can improve on that. So we find everybody, and we ask, okay, what's, from your point of view, rational or reasonable to embrace in the way of general principles which claim authority over your behavior? Now, authority, remember, means that these principles are able to override your particular interests when your interests happen to conflict with this. Okay? And this brings us to an important kind of paradox. If we ask, well, what is practical reason anyway? What is it to be a practically rational a reasonable person? I suggest that the answer goes something like this, and it's the standard insofar as there is an answer in the industry. This is the standard one. It's the only one I think that anybody has really been able to come up with that makes any sense. And that's this: to be a practically rationally, now remember, we're talking about practical reason. We're not talking about, for example, the ability to multiply 17 times 253 in 3 seconds, right? I mean, we're not talking about that sort of thing. We're not talking about the ability to know facts or to do demonstrations in mathematics, right? We're talking about practical reason. And what's practice? It's acting. It's getting things done. So what is it to be practically rational? Now, the answer, I think, is the following. Firstly, you've got to have some interests, as I will call them, or, if you like, values, or, if you like, desires. If you don't have any of those, you're not a practical being at all. In a longer lecture, I would mention computers and address the question whether computers have minds. And my answer to that question is, who cares? Because in any sense in which computers have minds, they certainly don't give a damn about what they do. maybe they can calculate like crazy, but if you ask a computer, you like calculating, the computer will in effect say, it'll shrug its shoulders. In fact, it won't do anything, of course, because it doesn't understand your question. If you don't have any desires or interests, you're simply not an acting being at all, and you're not in this picture. So, you gotta have something like this. However, number two, you gotta have the ability to acquire a bunch of facts about your situation. Now, if you've got that, plus some of that calculative ability, or reasoning, or if you like, word processing ability, then you're in a position to take the situation around you, put it together with your interests and desires, and come out with views about what the best thing for you to do is, all right? So you use two so as best to promote one. Sorry about my handwriting here. Okay, that is, the practically reasonable being is the guy who hitches the facts about his situation to his desires in such a way as to get the most of what he's interested in or what he wants. So far, so good. But this isn't morals yet. We can't deduce from this that anybody has an intrinsic, natural, inborn interest in being moral. And at this point, I want to add something fairly important, something which I think undoes most of the theories that are billed as natural law or natural rights theories. Now, those are ambiguous words, and there's a sense in which my theory is too. But there's an important sense in which it is not. If morality were literally natural, what would we expect? Morality being natural could mean something like this, that it's a principle of psychology, right? That the principles of morals are like principles of psychology. Now, if they were, and this is the trouble that St. Thomas Aquinas gets into in his ethical theory. If they were, the problem is that it would follow that everybody is moral. But they aren't. Right? I mean, the trouble with that kind of a theory is that obviously it's part of the idea of morals that these principles can be disobeyed by people, and often are. People are often immoral. If you have a theory that makes it impossible for people to be immoral, you might as well not bother to have a theory at all. It would be totally unrecognizable. In order for the theory to be, in the relevant sense, normative, to tell people in a meaningful way that they ought to do something, we have to envisage the possibility that they might not, right? So, we can't suppose then that people simply have an innate natural interest just like that in being moral. People don't naturally love each other, they love a few other people often, but, you know, except in some unfortunate cases, but hardly anybody loves everybody, for example. Again, it seems that we have to train people when they're kids to be nice, and we have to tell them, you know, you shouldn't hit people, and perhaps punish them for doing so, but at any rate, we have to do something to induce kids to become moral. It isn't natural in the sense in which it would be if morals were principles of psychology. Obviously, they're not. So, what are they, right? Now, plausible answer to this. Well, look, in order to have a rational morality, what do we want? We want to have a bunch of principles which everybody has reason to accept. Now, reason to accept means two things. A, it means when you and somebody else get into a discussion, and when you or he starts criticizing the other person's behavior, these are going to be principles to be appealed to, where the other person is going to say, oh yeah, okay, I see what you mean, right, I'm wrong and you're right. Or, conversely, I'm right and you're wrong. But principles that we can use to resolve disputes that might happen to arise. Now, how are we going to get a principle which is reasonable for everybody to use for that kind of purpose? I mean, that's, in a way, our basic question. Now, there are two possible candidates here. There are routes which will give you principles that a lot of people aren't interested in. Suppose, for example, that we've got some nice fancy principles about what to do, which are based on the voluminous writings of Aristotle. Now, I like Aristotle as much as the next guy, maybe even as much as Tibor. But I don't think that when I get into a dispute with somebody about whether he should have stolen this or that, I'm going to persuade him that what he does is wrong by saying, well, you know, you got to read Aristotle. And in fact, I think Aristotle doesn't really think so either, but that's a much more complicated subject, which we don't have time to get into. What I am going to say is, now look, in doing this kind of thing, right, in doing this kind of thing, you are taking advantage of me in a way that, you know, I could have taken advantage of you. Suppose, for example, that you and I make a deal, right? I mean, I buy a car from you. You give me the car, I give you $10,000, something like this, right? Now, suppose you give me the car and I haven't paid you yet. Question, all right, I've got my car, why should I give you the $10,000? Very important question. The answer to which is, well, but look, let's step back for a minute and ask, look, suppose that we didn't have a device like I promise, or I agree, or something like this, which would enable us to do things like achieving both of our preferences here. You prefer having the $10,000, I prefer having the car, instead of vice versa, which is the way that things are now. Now, if I knew that as soon as you got the car, you would bugger off and not give me the $10,000, I, of course, wouldn't give you the car. Or vice versa, whichever paid, you know, whichever does his part first. If we knew that we couldn't rely upon that person to do his part as well, then, of course, we wouldn't sign the deal in the first place, and the whole idea of deals would be useless. But notice that the result of this is that we would both be worse off. We wouldn't be able to avail ourselves of this very, very important device, of coming out both of us better off by virtue of both of us being willing to sacrifice a short-term improvement in our interests in return for a longer-term improvement. Okay? I'm better off with the $10,000, you're better off with the car, or I mean, I always get these things backward, you know, whichever it is. But the point is, it's in our interest to make the deal, but we can only make the deal if we both agree that we're going to keep it, if we can depend on each other to keep this kind of agreement. If we don't do this, we're both going to remain worse off than we were before. Now, in the case of ordinary face-to-face, local, low-level contracts like that, the point is really, I think, it's perfectly obvious to everybody here. The claim that there is an antecedent norm involved here, which is one of the things that Tibor makes a lot of in his written out version of his paper. He said only a little about it in his oral remarks here, but he makes a lot of it in his paper. But look, the claim that there's some kind of antecedent principle going on here has the following problem. Before we make the deal, I don't have an obligation to give you the car, and you don't have an obligation to give me the $10,000. Obviously not. Just because I'd be better off with the car, and you'd be better off with my $10,000, it doesn't follow that either of us has any obligation whatsoever. It's not until we say, okay, let's make the deal. We'll fake on it, we'll sign the contract, whatever. That's what obligates us to do it. And it isn't just the antecedent fact of the status of our interests, right? We need devices for enabling both of our interests to be realized, and that's where morals comes in. Now, let's generalize this some more, because cars and houses and so forth are certainly one very important kind of thing, and deals, small and large, occur all over the place. But now let's get down to the really fundamental situation. So, imagine, along with Thomas Hobbes, that we've got a society in which nobody has any morals at all. Nobody believes that anything is right or wrong, right? All we've got is our interests, and we have nothing as yet in the way of agreed principles of conduct. What's going to happen? Well, consider the possibility that it might be in somebody's interest to kill you, or vice versa, my interest to kill him. Now, unfortunately, it's pretty easy to imagine this, right?
I mean, maybe not you and I, because we're nice guys.
But if we look at mankind in general, it's pretty obvious down through the eons that it has frequently been the case that people have found it very much in their interest that certain other people end up dead. But of course, so long as this is the case, as Hobbes points out, what we're going to do is be tremendously afraid of everybody else. And we're going to spend a lot of our time just defending ourselves against other people, like Californians at gas stations that I learned the other day. You can't buy gas in California. You can't just say, fill her up, and then pay the guy. You got to pay him first. I don't feel that. Well, anyway. But in civilized countries, we can improve on this situation. Now, so let's go to Hobbes' the state of nature where there are absolutely no principles as yet and ask what life would be like. And Hobbes' answer seems to me to be very, very good. And it is, it'd be awful. It'd be awful for everybody. And the reason is that we would know that everybody would just be acting on his own interest without any modification. And the result of that is that everybody would be everybody's enemy. And the result of that in Hobbes' wonderful immortal prose is that life for men would be solitary, mean, nasty, brutish, and short. What's the problem? The problem is our capacity for violence, which, as Hobbes points out, is something that essentially all of us have. In fact, as he puts it, when it comes to strength of body, each of us has enough to kill any other person, right? The weakest hath enough to kill the strongest. That's pretty important. I mean, if we know that everybody's capable of doing things like this, and that everybody has interests such that they might very well want to do something like this, you can see why life would be perfectly miserable unless we accepted some general constraining principles that said, okay, look, what we're doing in effect is saying, look, I'll let you live if you let me live, right? Or more generally, I will refrain from using violence against you if you refrain from using it against me. We're all in a situation such that we'll do better if we've got a deal like that, if we've got a principle like that. And the proposal is that that is indeed the foundation of it. The foundation of morals is we'll all be better off if we've got principles which restrict our capacity to inflict miserable lives on other people and confine ourselves to the various kinds of interrelations that will enable us to each be better off. That's the foundation of it, and I can't see that there is any other kind of reasoning about society that can improve on this one.
So what I'd like to do is, instead of having an immediate 5-minute response from each of the speakers, what I think I'll do is instead open it up to the Q&A, and in the course of that, they can respond as topics are raised. The issue in there's a couple things that I might...
See what a social contract is good for?
That's right.
He changes it in midway.
Part of it is that at least one speaker didn't go by the time limit. One of the things I'd like to sort of throw out to the audience and see if it's of interest is relating to the idea of what is the basis of a free society and so forth. There is an essay written about 100 years ago called No Treason by an attorney, an abolitionist in Boston by the name of Lysander Spooner. His view was that not only was there's no basis to the Hobbesian view, but there was no basis to the social contract itself if you did not sign it. It was a very specific view that obligations were only those that you entered into voluntarily. So why don't we open up to Q&A, and in the course, both speakers can comment on each other as well. So. Also, if you wait for Carl, he has the microphone.
Dr. Narveson, at the risk of oversimplifying your argument, it seems like it comes down to crime doesn't pay, that in a properly structured society, a potential criminal can reason forward and say in the long term, this is a bad idea. But I think we all know that, at least in most societies, most people, even when faced with a norm-violating action that has no possible repercussions, you find somebody else's wallet on the street, you can take the money and throw it in the trash, your specific action would never harm you in any way. A rational but unprincipled response would be to take the money and throw the wallet in the trash. But we all know that people don't act like that. And I can't help thinking that we're reasoning about this wrong. The question is not why do people do this, but how else could they act? If we had a society where people acted rationally but unprincipled, this society would fall apart, right? The only societies that survive that are those that have enough people in them that that behave according to society's principles, even in disregard for their own interests.
What's your question?
You seem to disagree. You seem to think that...
Not with any of what you said so far.
Well,
my whole point is...
Well, you can just sit here.
You've got to have principles that constrain the operation of self-interest when self-interest is contrary to your interest in the social context. So we need principles that say, you know, don't do this in this situation, even when you could get away with it.
But isn't that just tantamount about the saying, giving him a copy of Aristotle and saying, here, read this?
No, it isn't. Because you can read Aristotle, you're blue in the face, and you might not end up persuaded that it would be, you know, a good idea to have principles like this rather than something else. In fact, if you read Aristotle, what you're likely to find out is that there's a bunch of really hotshot types, which is what society should be all about, and that there ought to be a bunch of slaves down there supporting them, which is roughly what Greek society was like. Right? Now,
but in my society, I don't give a damn about slaves and masters. I mean, I don't give a damn about people who are hotshots and intellectuals and read Aristotle. Everybody, regardless of their interests and so forth, is capable of doing violence to everybody else. What we need is a principle that just generally proscribes violence. Now, if you're saying that the principle might need to be enforced, of course, I agree with this. Among the things that we will include in the social understanding is that people who do this to people are liable to be in various ways punished, right? And we will also have sub-principles about how much they can be punished. All this can be spelled out in the general structure. It's quite true to say, by the way, as David said, I mean, the social contract in this very general sense is not something anybody ever signed, right? And the reason for that is that it appeals to general properties of the social situation. And it says, look, anybody with any reason at all can see that you've got to have this kind of constraining principles in order to make the society work. And if society doesn't work, you, in the long run, are going to be miserable. So that's what we have to do.
Let me make a couple of points. One is, you know, people are not usually arguing that people should read Aristotle. The word Aristotle comes in as a buzzword to indicate what sort of argument that you're putting forth, and the same way that Hobbes comes in to indicate what sort of argument you're putting forth. I mean, people are just going to listen to arguments, and some of them are more Aristotelian arguments, and some of them more Hobbesian arguments, but you can drop out those names, and you're still dealing with arguments. And people are going to have to listen to some sort of reason in order to get them to behave in certain ways, and some of them won't, and some of them will. So we're not really in any big disagreement about it. I don't want to have them. And there are also problems with, I mean, Aristotle believed in slavery, Hobbes believed in an almighty leader. So we all have liabilities and assets, so there's no big, you know, there's not a, you know, I got you and you got me here on this issue. However, I do think that we have a problem with, if we don't have anything better than the agreement to back the behavior that that agreement is supposed to engender, then it is very possible that sometime folks who think they can get away without heeding the agreement because maybe a mistake, maybe they think they're big enough, maybe they think they're smart enough to get out of having to abide by the agreement, there's going to be chaos because they're not bound by anything else except the agreement. And the agreement is just a momentary thing. They agreed yesterday, but today they might not agree. If their self-interest, to use that term in this way, suddenly indicates to them, hey, wait a minute, drop the agreement, go for something else. There is nothing in the social contractarian view that should impel them to abide by the agreement. Whereas in the more Aristotelian view that I was outlining, and forget the Aristotelian, the view that I was outlining, there is at least some possibility that a norm may be found that requires you, in order to be a decent human being, to keep your promises, for example. So whether you get away with violating your promises or not, you should keep your promises.
Tibor.
And there is a stronger view behind the contract if there is a norm underlying it. There's a moral value that stands behind the contract.
Tibor, name it.
I just said, promise keeping.
Look, all you have done is to say we ought to keep our promises. I agree with this. So, if you think that there is something further that underlies it that you've got that I don't have, tell us what it is.
I already indicated that. I mean, you may maintain that there is nothing underlying the social contract that is...
I told you what it is. It's everybody's interest.
Wait a minute. I got to have some space here.
Right.
Is that in the contract?
Now, I think that there is an argument to be made that given the kind of things we are, human beings, we live our lives more successfully, more better, if we abide by our words.
I agree with that. I've said it.
Now, but according to the social contractarian approach, this is not true. The only thing backing up our promises is that we made an agreement to keep the promise, rather than a prior principle that says, if you make an agreement, you have to keep it. There is nothing in social contractarianism that requires one to keep the promise that one makes.
The reason why a lot of this is so germane to what everyone is facing is because every day there are laws passed. And the question is, what is the legitimate basis to laws? What rights do you have to property? What rights do you have to anything compared to what a legislature or a bureaucrat or anyone else would say? Carl?
Perhaps something a little more fundamental. I have three parts here that are pretty brief. Two are historical, and one of them is somewhat biological, and then there's a genetic issue. In the Wild West, there was much anarchy. The law had not arrived. And yet, the people who were there when crime was intolerable, even though it was much lower than today, they formed committees of vigilance and took care of the bad actors. Now, that's one part. Does that either support or contradict the question of a social compact? Second, there was a famous 18th or 19th century railroad accident where a worker was tamping explosives in the tamping iron was blown through his cheek and out the top of his head. Before this, he was a very sturdy worker, reliable, honest, even-tempered, sober, polite. Following this, he was very antisocial, unreliable, and a drunk, and very rude and cruel to women. And lately, we have had scientific evidence learned that girls, as have often been noticed, tend to socialize. Not in any particular society, but in any society, tend to socialize without as much outside pressure as it requires for boys. And they have learned that there are some girls that need just as much outside pressure to socialize, and they share a common genetic defect to the X chromosome that their father had, that their father gave them. Now, do these then support a question or an issue that says that normative behavior has an inherent biological component or genetic foundation?
Well, that gets back to Tibor's point about human nature.
You know, we all have temptations, whether that's a biologically based fact about us or whether it is a socially based fact about us, we also sometimes overcome them. I sometimes have a temptation to go on talking a long time. And once in a while, I manage to overcome this temptation. Whether I have a chromosome-based inclination to talk or not, it does seem like I have some power over my behavior. If I don't, if we look at the human situation entirely in terms of this biological deterministic framework you outline, then, you know, it doesn't matter anyway. Because que sera, sera, we just want to do the things that we're going to do, and there is no point of my, I mean, it's not even addressable. If it's just one step in a long daisy chain of ineluctable events, then forget about it, you know. But if there is some power we have over these impulses, these temptations, and so on, then the question of morality can arise. And I think regarding that issue, I believe that Jan and I are pretty much in the same boat. I don't know for sure, but I tend to think so.
Go ahead, Jan.
Let me say just a couple words about this. Obviously, the possibility of morality working presupposes that people are able somehow or other to respond to things like, you know, training, childhood and otherwise, and that people are able to do this. Some people probably are not. Those people are a problem. I mean, we all recognize this, and it's just as obvious on my view as in anybody else's that it's a problem, and it's no more obvious on mine than anybody else's what the solution is. All you can do is dig in and see, right? I mean, maybe we'll find some kind of chemical or whatnot that can restore the operation of the sort of moral part of the brain of the guy with the tube blown through his head. All I'm saying is we've got a problem here, and we all can realize that it's a problem because of these kinds of considerations, including him, by the way. I mean, people, you know, thieves realize why we've got principles of private property. Indeed, thieves need it. I mean, suppose everybody paid no attention whatsoever to property rights, including the thieves. Obviously, you're not going to make your living by stealing. While you're out stealing somebody else's stuff, they're busy stealing yours, and you're no further ahead, right? Thieves depend upon the existence of these principles. I mean, that's the thing. Thieves are making an exception of themselves. And that's, of course, contrary to the whole idea of social principles, and we all want to do something about them. Now, what we want to do, addressing your first question, which is a very important one, is another very large subject. And a standard answer has been, well, that's what we need the state for. And, of course, Hobbes, in a very big way, proposed that answer. Now, I think Hobbes's political philosophy is as wrong as his moral philosophy is right. And dependence on the state for this purpose, I think, is a terrible mistake. You've probably been reading Bruce Benson. I'll put in a plug for everybody else as well. I mean, he's one of the important people to read in modern times for instruction in why relying on the state for this purpose isn't maybe a good idea, and you might do better with the Vigilante Committee. Indeed, yeah. I mean, contractarian reasoning explains why that's the kind of thing that's likely to come about, and, you know, why rational people will do things like that.
Just as a plug again, I'm never too hesitant. Our most recent book is Bruce Benson's latest book called To Serve and Protect. Any question here?
The thought of self-interest has risen in both of your comments, sometimes disparagingly. It seems to me that there's a rational and an irrational self-interest, and to refer to Mr. Machan's book, calling upon the moral authority of an individual's own space, it strikes me that that is the rational self-interest that maybe, and I'm not sure I understand this thoroughly enough, that underlies the dispute between you in that if we can define morality as a rational self-interest and immorality as that irrational self-interest that does not respect the moral authority of another individual space, that then there's some basis upon which to go. And clearly, there needs to be some societal effort to constrain the irrational exercise of self-interest.
You know, there is really a lot of literature on this, and there's you know, endless debate about whether you can make out a concept of rational self-interest at all. Some people argue that self-interest really means whatever you want, and it is in your interest. Because you want it, it constitutes your self-interest. There is nothing more to be said. And that means that whether you want to drown yourself in drugs, or whether you want to waste your life away, or build cathedrals, or play music, it's all the same. It's all a case of self-interest. I would consider that a sort of meaningless use of the term self-interest, because it allows everything. The bank robber is exercising his self-interest. The bank teller is exercising his self-interest. It starts not to explain any kind of behavior. However, if there is a more a clearer understanding of what the self is, then some things will be to the interest of oneself when one wants those things, and some things won't, even though one may want them. But that is not the most popular use of the term self-interest. I mean, we can go on forever discuss it, but I just wanted to lay this out. There really are two sides on this. Some conception of self-interest are so broad that it includes anything you do, anything you want. Some are more narrow, just the way in which you sort of suggest.
By the way, in the broader debate over issues like constitutional law and what is considered to be legal, issues that these two gentlemen are talking about is really fundamental to be able to sort out these questions. In other words, let's say that we come to the opinion that the income tax is a bad thing. Well, if we decide that the income tax is a bad thing, then the question is, well, how do we persuade other people, which is part of what they're discussing? The second bigger question, though, is why is it a bad thing? Is it because it's immoral, fundamentally, which is basically what Tibor is saying in his book that many of you have? So in that respect, you're basically talking about the idea of a concept of justice, getting back to Jan's point, that is above what is viewed as statutory law or the law of different organizations.
I want to speak to this gentleman, because he's raising, in a way, the most fundamental issue here. Now look, on my view, you can't find out, it doesn't matter for our purposes, whether you want to say that certain particular interests looked at in themselves are rational or irrational. There are people who actually listen to rock music, for example. These people are clearly irrational. I mean, I don't understand people like that. But it's irrelevant to morals and politics. When we look to morals and politics, we ask not what are your interests, but what do they motivate you to do in relation to other people? Now, it would be an irrational principle or an irrational move to make to say, let's not have any moral principles constraining anybody from doing anything. That would be irrational. It would also be irrational to have a principle that said, okay, everybody's got to be Roman Catholic or something like that. Why? Because lots and lots of us aren't. And all that's going to do is put us at war with the people who are. It's not going to enable different people to live their various lives the way they want to live them, right? So what will make a moral principle, irrational moral principle, is that it's acceptable to everybody regardless of their interests and whether you think that those interests are inherently rational or not.
By the way, the most important example is the drug laws. I mean, America currently is putting hundreds of thousands of people in jail for what? For liking rock music, or for smoking marijuana. Same kind of thing, right? For having the wrong tastes. No good.
Jan, aren't you saying that your real self-interest lies in adhering to the contract?
Well, I'm saying that no matter what your interests are, you will do better in a social contract I mean, in a social situation, by accepting a broad principle, broad principles of certain kinds, namely kinds which enable everybody, including you, to live the kind of lives that they want to live to the maximum possible degree.
And presumably that's in everyone's interest.
Yes.
Yes. It's in their rational self-interest, yes.
Well, I mean, it's rational for them to do that, but notice that the rationality doesn't come from the particular character of their interest. It comes from the way their interests relate to other people. Like, if I like hash, for example, I mean, one thing I could do is go out and shoot other people and take their hash. Another thing I could do is buy it from them and then smoke it, right? Now, the kind of actions which principles of the contractarian type, I mean, the kind of moves it will sanction are moves forbidding the second kind of action, but allowing the first kind. I mean, you want to buy the pot and smoke it yourself? Fine, no problem. Whether you smoke pot is not other people's business. You may suffer from it. That's too bad for you. In his written out paper, Tibor claims that my view presupposes, you know, that prudence is a norm. It doesn't. It's not a moral norm. There's no morality requiring you to be prudent. If you want to be a stupid nit and kill yourself, fine. As long as you don't kill the rest of us in the process, you can do as you like, right? That's what makes it wrong. And what would be irrational would be to accept moral principles that were inconsistent with your interests, or to not accept any principles at all, and thus put yourself at the mercy of, at the mercy of everybody.
But if you
let me just quickly chime in here with one thing. Jan and I have a disagreement about the scope of ethics and morality, I think. He indicated that in the state of nature, there is no morality. I don't believe that. I believe that in a state of nature, you do need morality, and if you are immoral, you meet with serious consequences, even if you're just all by yourself on a desert island. For example, I consider prudence a virtue. So now, if I'm imprudent on a desert island, I'll drown. I won't have anything to eat. I'll ruin my life. This is a more Aristotelian view of the nature of morality or ethics. A later conception of morality that comes in with Hobbes in big ways is where morality pertains only to interpersonal relationships and has nothing to do with how you behave on your own. Now, that is a fundamental disagreement. Now, the problem is that really is two different theories about morality. The concept morality is not uncontroversial. There is debate about what constitutes morality. Jan wants to basically legislate that his conception of morality is the right conception.
Yep.
I think we need to debate that issue. I don't have as much gall as he has to just say, hey, my conception of morality is the right. Obviously, I would like to argue that, but this is not the place where I can make that out. So I will leave that just as a hypothesis rather than as a fait accompli.
You had a question.
Thank you. First, pleasure to hear you both speak. I offer a view on this, and I ask your comments. It seems to me there's an idealistic view that you've written at the bottom here with your moral and political principles, and item two says claim authority. I'd suggest there's a de facto or realistic view where you would replace item two with impose authority. And that's what's really going on in the world. And that doesn't require agreement. It requires a gang that's strong enough, whether it's 5% or 80% of a society. 80% might be reasonable people. 50% might be the ones with guns. So it seems to me we need to differentiate between idealism and agreement versus imposed authority, and recognize that what's going on in the world today is imposed authority. Some majorities or power structures are what we call nice guys, and some aren't. And we have that mixture, and we always will. Comments?
Which gets really to Benson's.
That's true, but it isn't really relevant. See, I mean, it's not
relevant.
Why not?
That's what's going on.
Well, it's not relevant because our question is, what's the right morality? There are lots of different, any cultural anthropologist will say, well, look, here's a bunch of different societies, and they've all got different sets of moral codes. End of story. Right? He's just telling you a lot of facts about it. That's what you're telling us. And the morality of any given society is what the people in that society impose on each other, period. True. But the question is, could they improve on it? Or could there possibly be some reasons why we should have this feature rather than some other features of morality? And might we be able to improve on them if we don't have them right now? In order to answer that, we're going to have to do something fancier than just go around and looking at and seeing who actually is beating up on whom. Our question is, well, are the right guys beating up on the right guys? And maybe the answer is no. In the case of America at present and the drug laws, I think the answer is for sure not. We can improve on this.
So can I say quickly just something?
De facto and ideal theory, and we're doing ideal theory here.
I want to just quickly make a remark about the word natural, because I don't want to lose the opportunity to do that. Jan equates natural, I think, with regular, to be expected, sort of like a cat naturally meows, a dog naturally barks. The concept natural, in my framework, doesn't function this way. It's more on the order of, it is natural depending upon what the nature of something is. And the nature of something isn't what it regularly does, but more what it distinguishes it from other things. Now, in the case of a choosing being like human beings, being like you and I, who have choices we can make, we can choose to be more in accord with our nature or less. Consider, for example, that I'm a professor of philosophy. As I teach my classes, I could engage in indoctrination or telling personal stories or stuff like that. My students would be very happy. They wouldn't have to read anything. They could just laugh and have a good time. It would not fit with my nature as a professor of philosophy to behave that way. It might be natural in the sense that McCann does that a lot, but that's not the relevant sense of natural in that context.
Why not?
It's more, because there are two different concepts of the word nature. Nature didn't say anything. It is my nature as a professor that what I ought to be doing is to present the material to my students in a reasonably impartial fashion. If I don't do that, I am violating the principles of being a professor, which comes out of what the nature of a professor is. Now, some people don't like that use of the term natural. I simply don't want it legislated out of existence. Jan just legislates it out of existence. He didn't give an argument why this conception of nature is bad or incoherent or pointless. He just said, that's not what I mean by nature. Well, that's what I mean by nature.
Okay, one more question.
If it isn't, I can't see the relevance.
Two more questions. I promised Fred too. Go ahead. Go first.
Yes. The notion of social compact and its application to us as we build our societies, it strikes me that it breaks down as our geographic boundaries and or political boundaries aggregate and get larger. That social compact would apply very well in a small neighborly community, perhaps in a township size. But when you add that up to county, to state, suddenly to the federal, and when we start talking about addressing everybody, claiming authority, and doing that at a federal level, it removes from us as individuals that opportunity to be distinctly different. If it was kept at the local level, at the very least, if we don't agree with the compact, we can move to the next locality. But it's very hard to move from to a different country. I'd ask the two professors if they could comment on what we might do, if I've got an accurate view of that, and if so, what we might do to slow down the aggregation of our political boundaries.
Well, you know, one of my problems with social contractarianism is precisely that prior to reaching any kind of agreement, you need to put forth arguments. Now, you can reach agreements with people who are pretty much of the same background, with the same traditions and so on. There, the problem doesn't face you so much. to present to them convincing arguments that they should come around and abide by certain principles, because they are growing out of the same tradition and it's sort of tacitly homogeneous population. But when we do go across to Canada, Mexico, Latin America, Asia, and so on, then I think we need something that appeals to their reason, their reasoning ability, not just to their interests, but their reasoning ability. And so that if we, I don't say that's a slam dunk by any means. I mean, there's a lot of cases where no matter how rational you are, how good your arguments are, you're going to be rebuffed nevertheless. But I think you have a better chance if you approach them with some kind of a rational argument to which they then have a chance to say, yeah, that makes sense, therefore I will agree to this, rather than sort of like hope that there is going to be an agreement, you know? And that's the way I see the advantage of going to folks with some reasons that will lead them, if they do think about it, to embrace certain principles, rather than simply hope that they'll embrace the principles because in some sense it is more to their advantage to do so. I want to say, well, why is it more to their advantage? What shows this? And I think that that can be done more if you actually employ arguments prior to the agreement. But maybe in some ways at this level, we may be actually closer here, because I think that Jan would also probably believe that we need to come to them with some sort of an argument for them to accept the basic social principles, but his arguments might be a little bit different. They would be something like, well, notice you will get to do the things that you like to do, and other people will get to do the things that they would like to do, and we'll all get to do the things that we would like to do if we abide by these principles. I would be actually more likely to give the argument that we would be better off in a more robust sense, that as human beings, our life would be better if we had abided by these principles. Whether there's a lot of difference here or not, I'm not so sure.
In Benson's work, before Jan says anything, so then his view gets back to the question over here also, is that there is a natural tendency, talking about the world natural, for people to develop agreements because there are benefits that outweigh the costs. Not to say that there's a universal tendency, but there is a tendency, and that's where the actual concept of the rule of law comes from, is that motivation to create some sort of a predictable and systematic basis for agreements. And the one question that was actually raised about the Wild West, it turns out that, as both of our speakers probably know, is that the so-called Wild West wasn't that wild. And the reason why it wasn't that wild was because people, based on their natural interests, formed contracts and covenants to police and protect themselves against aggressors. Fred had a question.
Wait a minute.
I'm sorry, go ahead, Jeff.
Keep getting left out here.
Sorry.
There's a plot going on here. Look, your question raises a very important and another very fundamental kind of issue, and that's the nature of what unites us all here, namely the belief in liberty. Now, the reason why liberty, I mean, I'm claiming, it's been my shtick in social philosophy down through these years, that liberty has the peculiar property of being the only thing that we've all got in common is an interest. That the widest principle there can be is the general principle of liberty, which says, do whatever you like, as long as you allow everybody else to do whatever they like. So it's the maximum consistent liberty that unites people of our interest. Now, about boundaries, people have characteristically believed that the people it's wrong to kill are your next door neighbors, but the guys on the other side of the hill, that's perfectly all right. I mean, if they live over in Kosovo, well, you know, what the hell? And we libertarians think, no, that's not right. We want a universal agreement that nobody gets to kill anybody, and also that nobody gets to kill anybody just because they don't like the color of their skin or even their taste in music, right? What I want to say is we want a universal boundary-less principle to the general effect that we're going to prohibit violence, and we're going to allow everything else, and only little groups of people will forbid other things. Yes, I mean, in that sense, what you say is right. Little groups of people, like you've got a commune over here, it's going to have a whole bunch of rules. And people who don't like it, good, they can go somewhere else. But people who live in the world can't go somewhere else. And we want to find the principles which will unite everybody. And that principle, I think we claim, is the principle of general liberty. The principle says, well, it's wrong to do violence to people, and that's it.
Fred.
Jan, if I understand your argument correctly, it's that there is no inherent morality in human beings. However, it's in our rational common interest to avoid aggression against one another. Is that?
Yep.
Yeah. But, for example, in the Kosovo example, the Serbs, or some Serbs, would rather endure temporary violence and get rid of the non-Serbs, and for that matter, the Europeans who came to North America thought it was in their rational interest to eliminate the Indians, or at least most of them, and conquer their land. Yeah. So if this is their end, if this is what they wanted and felt that this would benefit them, how is this not rational for those people?
Oh, yeah. Well, the question is it rational for them to say, this is the thing to do? It isn't, is it rational for them to do it just like that? Our question is it rational for them to say, okay, anybody who doesn't like somebody else gets to go ahead and kill them. If there's more of them, you know, then they're in the right.
What if they're just
now, if that's what they're going to say, then of course they're inviting all the people who are more numerous than the Serbs to come along and say, well, we don't like the Serbs, so let's rub them out. Right? All the people who are more numerous than the Germans, well, let's rub them out, etc., right? I mean, when you contemplate the kind of social principles you're buying into when you say that acting on interests like that is perfectly okay, you see what you're getting into, and if you've got any sense, you're going to withdraw. And you'll notice that Serbs don't say that. I mean, they don't claim that there's a general right to do this kind of thing. Indeed, I mean, Milosevic, who is a son of a bitch, doesn't say anything of this sort. He just says, I want it. Well, that's the kind of people we have to worry about in this world.
You're appealing to universality and generality here.
Yep.
They can't kill the Kosovars because it's wrong to kill. But is there anything inherently wrong about a morality that says, okay, you're allowed to kill Kosovars? You can't kill anybody else, but we're going to kill Kosovars.
Well,
this is exceptional.
Okay, the proposed model here is we're looking for a set of principles which would be rational for everybody to agree to. Do you think it would be rational for people in Kosovo to agree to that?
If we say, hey, morality that said you couldn't stop other people from using drugs, a person whose interest were
one thing at a time.
Drugs,
your particular example was Kosovo, so yeah. I'm asking you, is this in the interest of the people in Kosovo?
No.
Okay. Period. I mean,
yeah.
Right?
If you ask,
well, why should we have morality at all? Which, of course, is a very important question. I agree to that. And the answer is, if you don't have morality at all, you're inviting enemies, you're inviting war, and that's what you're going to get.
But no morality is completely universal. If your personal interest, well, I need to stop you from taking hash, a libertarian ethic doesn't work for
this. This morality is perfectly universal, and it includes that one. I mean, the thing about stopping you from taking hash stops at you, because you aren't going to agree to this principle.
We're saying,
right? So it certainly lies in universality.
Let me just make a quick point.
Tibor has the last word.
One of the reasons that I have always thought that some sort of a prior framework of morality is necessary before one can forge a social morality or a political morality is that at the level of politics, there's a great temptation to think that you're always cleverer than the others. And if no prior morality can have any impact on your thinking and on your behavior, then at that point, the simple belief that you can get away with dodging the agreement, that simple belief, even if it's wrong, but you happen to believe it, will suffice for you to violate the social contract. And I would like to block that option rather than wait until they find out 10 years from now, oh my God, what have we done? Now we open the floodgates to retaliation, and they're going to kill us. I would like to have an argument for them now. Even if they are not likely to listen to it, at least I will know that the argument exists, and some of them might think about it. But if they need to sort of try out the social contract or try out dodging it, I think we're going to be in a perpetual efforts to circumvent the social contract, which ultimately is going to invalidate any sort of general moral political principle that I think that Jan really wants us to adopt.
I'm not sure you know what you're saying when you say this, Tibor, but it sounded to me as though you're saying, yes, well, you may spend 20 years reading Aristotle, but at least you've got it. I mean,
anyway,
I don't understand why you can think that that's better.
Anyway, obviously this discussion is one that can continue, and we hope that you'll pursue it.
You mean?
And will.
And will. One thing I want to point out, I mean, the Kosovo example, of course, is a great one, because for any of us to figure out what is right and not in Kosovo, you have to say, well, NATO and the U.S. are bombing Kosovo. They're imposing rules there by bombing. The Serbs are imposing order on people that by forcing them to leave their homes and killing them. The same thing is true from the KLA, which has pursued similar policies, especially historically, and so on and so forth. So the argument is that the point is that this esoteric discussion is directly relevant to the issue of how do we determine what is just, and if we can determine what is just, how do we then pursue to essentially establish that in a universal way, i.e. to have a free society itself. So whether you're talking about taxes or job regulation or marriage regulation or whatever it might be. So I certainly hope that you'll pursue this by looking at Tibor's book, as well as hopefully when Jan's book gets reprinted, we hope it will. Tibor's book, I will point out, what he does and what makes the book very unique is that where there are many books that you can get on the economic critique of all different kinds of regulations and government policies, which are very powerful and important to understand, the difference with Tibor's book is that Tibor is taking an ethical and moral analysis of these policies to see if these are actually just acts, on top of the fact that the policies themselves may create contradictory and even worse situations than.
I think they know that you want them to buy the book.
They've already bought it. So anyway. Thank you all for coming. I want to thank both of our speakers.
Thank you very much.
Our distinguished speakers.